My name is Stijn de Kruijf, working for Royal Ice Coating and DHV. About 22 years now. So happy to be here today. It's a follow-up of last year. I presented also last year here with the four principles. And for today, it's a follow-up on that. My daily job is data center engineer and consultancy. So I designing the data center. So for me, OCP is really key to understand because, yeah, when we design a facility, it's built in 1 year and then you have to operate for 15 years. And so it's good to understand the requirements of the next generation data centers. This slide, probably you know already. When OCP started in 2011, it was not very known. And from 2016 it appeared. In 2016 I joined the facility group. I'm happy to work together with the group members. It's really fun and it's also good to share knowledge between us. So 2016 it popped up also more in the news and then it reached out. And as a data center facility designer, we have all kind of guidelines and requirements in the market to help us to design a facility which is able to put a rack in. That's the all kind of the ASHRAE, the Big C, the uptime. They are telling us how what the rack needs as a facility on power, cooling, and the building. But OCP is different, and the gap is getting bigger and bigger, and that's the reason too, also for this presentation. So, from the past, there's first as a facility group, it was good to understand, to tell what OCP requirements were for the facility. So, the start was putting down the co-location facility guidelines, which tells, okay, we have OCP gear and what should the facility have as a minimum requirements to put the IT gear in. So that's the facility guidelines. It's there for 3 years now. Mark Denzi will tell about it at 1 o'clock more. So last year there was the fourth principles, because the idea was not only do it one way, it's only also the other way around. OCP is based on principles. What principles are key to develop the next generation data centers that also the facility benefits from OCP. So it takes an active role in achieving the goals. So that was the principal discussion from last year. I will do a wrap up quickly. And in the summit this year and in San Jose, US, we thought, now let's put those principles in front of a panel. And there was a 1 hour discussion on a panel, also audience polling. That was very interesting to see. There's a video online, but yeah, I will tell you today a wrap up, so you don't have to look at the 1 hour video. So it will not be a consensus model, but it's just panel feedback about principles. And then today we are here. So the four principles wrap up, then the just the feedback on the panel on San Jose, and then something about data center footprint, circular approach. These are the four principles as presented last year. First one was simplifying. We should simplify the facility. If we look at the designer as a facility, we use 50% of the cost of the facility is not used for 99% of the time. So that's a good debate. What can we skip to reduce the cost of the facility and not put all that additional resilience equipment in? Picture was last year, from last year was we are designing kind of a Tesla with six wheels because we want to still drive 200 kilometers if we have two flat tires. That's the idea. And should we really do this? So that's Yeah. We can also say, yeah, let's put it at 50 kilometers an hour to a garage, repair it, and then full blow ahead. Yeah. We looked at the second principle, that was the questions we can ask, because from the past, normal say, yeah, we cannot have a power down in a data center because then the everything breaks, the whole society breaks. It's too, we have to be reliable, but that's not the case anymore. The data center is more intelligent, and we, you can do better questions. If we have, for instance, a storage environment, and the power fails, the data is not lost. It's maybe less. You cannot reach out to the data, for instance, or with a lower speed, but it's not lost. So, asking those questions to the data center as a total can give some interesting insights. Third principle was the UPS. One of the core principles of OCP is putting a UPS in the rack. There are three flavors. There was an in-row UPS, an indirect UPS, and a centralized UPS. But the first ideas of OCP, let's put a UPS in the rack. And that has had a reason. And if we have those racks with UPSs, that makes it also possible that the whole facility breaks down. You have to have also some cooling, but there's time to think. So you can, there's the ability for the software to ramp down the networking or the storage or the compute environments in case the emergency power isn't going to be live. You can switch over processes, there's time. So the UPS gives really time in the data center to do something with your software stack. And one is very in the news also, also in the main track, it was the ability to communicate between software, IT hardware, and the facility. Redfish, the Intel study is also together with Baidu. They produced a paper for OCP, and it's also orchestrated by the Redfish layer to to have an ability to communicate between the different layers in a data center. So IT can put out signals to the facility. But also maybe it's an idea the other way around. The facility is saying, "Oh, please do a little less, or do a little right or left, and communicate to the IT." It's very interesting. And then we come to an integrated data center design. It's software, IT, hardware, facility. So wrapping this up, the facility principles, the four principles on the left. So try to slice down what you don't need in a data center. Rethink of guidelines. Use the UPS system. There's great opportunities, and even more with integrated communication. And that's come together as an open data center, as one. So this was a wrap up of last year. Then we went this year to the summit in San Jose. We realized from, okay, now we have ideas. Let's put them in front of a panel. Robert was doing a good job getting some interesting people together to have good discussions. And Robert act as a moderator in this. So we had Mike Eady from Facebook, myself, Russ Lindsay from Salesforce, we have Mike Moore from Nokia, and Dale Santor from Berkeley Laboratory. So that was a great mix of people. to put to confront with some questions and to see what they responded. And I will now, on the next slides, there will be a wrap up what was coming back. We did also in the meantime an audience polling. We thought about it this year, but the time frame was too short. So it's just one way. And so the bar below gives an idea where the answer was on the question. Was yes or no in the audience. And in the middle are some feedback of the question. First question was 35 degrees, so 95 degrees Fahrenheit. How about it? Let's do it. Why not? Now, feedback on those questions. Why not? The OCP gear can handle 40 degrees, so yeah, let's do it. Liquid cooled servers can do even more, higher temperatures. So yeah, it's giving opportunities to make the facility, to improve the facility on costs and also on sustainability. But there was also a big no, because that's not a healthy working environment, was the response. So this is not a consensus model, this is just feedback from the panel. There was not the objective to have consensus in the end. So really the working environment is a key thing. So not 100% all the time 35 degrees. Maybe on the hotter days outside you can hotter, have it a little hotter in the data center. That's more acceptable. Air management is a key. There were already feedback that if you go higher in temperature temporary or instantly, there you get recirculation issues. So fans are speeding up and in rack circulation. So air management is really key to have it done. And also the GPUs and the CPUs were not happy with higher temperatures yet. So that's really a design thing, that also the GPUs and the CPUs will be designed with cold plate the liquid cooling as presented this morning, or better spec that they can handle the air. Otherwise, they are holding back the rest of the stack, which can handle 40 degrees. So a Dale answer from Dale. It's okay for scientific computing. They have big calculations to do, but yeah, they can do it also on higher temperatures, and that clock speed is automatically controlled. So, and also they can shift the workload over to another data center. For the facility, it saves money. Really, if you have a climate which you can do 35 degrees compressorless non-stop, and it's really interesting for a data center facility. Not only that you don't have to buy chillers, but it's you can have a very easy principle of the facility. And also feedback was the edge. The open edge is really further in degrees, which they can handle. So they are not used to chillers, and they are not used to the data center environment. They can handle, they are more robust, and they can handle 45, 55 degrees. So that equipment is much more robust. The audience, you can see, was a little green, little more green than orange. We did polling before the question, after the question, but this was the average which was coming out. So very interesting, but yeah, not a no go. Second question was the emergency generator. Can we do with less? Yeah. So why not? We have sites, Sweden, Netherlands, but also other sites where we have high availability grids. So yeah, why invest in generators? The feedback was still that Because it's also causing issues. That was agreed in the panel also. It costs money in the capex, opex. You have regulations, emissions. Yeah, you don't want to have them. But on the other hand, it's still a no-go area. The software stack is key, and they want still to rely on a data center which have an uptime of 100%. So that's a big pushback. Of course, scientific computing can do without. They can shut down for a couple of hours and no problem. Also interesting. Third question was to see if there's a market for in-rack UPS. So we have the Colo designs still providing centralized UPS. And the reaction was, yeah, there's no solid market request for colos now to build data centers without centralized UPS. You can be the first in the market to do it without, but still, the market is not requesting for data centers without centralized UPS. There was also, in line with that, there was also say, we want to have the racks populated with compute, and we don't want to lose the 2 OU in the rack for those UPSs. So we want to populate it full stop with compute and the rest of the stack. The other way is they recognize it's easy if the UPS is in the rack, because then the facility above the infrastructure above it is much more easier. You don't have to do closed transitions. You can do open transitions. So they really recognize it's good to have the UPS in the rack. So no, it's there was a little more green than orange, but still good to develop further. Beyond the rack is what is the increment? I'll speed up a little bit. The increment, what can fail? Normally was a server in a rack could not fail. A rack is not allowed to fail. We have 2N supplies to a rack. That's quite the standard at the moment. But can we allow a rack to fail? That's currently the answer, yes. But the rack row, can we also fill a rack row? Because that's also very interesting for cost perspective on a data center. If you don't have a double rail over all the racks, that makes also sense. And not a tap off, dual tap off to every rack. And the answer here was, if you have, it's depending on the business. But on the large scale software stacks, they all already think of rack row failure, even a data center failure. So it's good to look at it further. First question was the standard guidelines. So why are the standard guidelines still focusing on a data center as a facility, still the gap with the IT hardware and the IT software even more? Why don't throw them away and provide new one, just defining the resilience on a software stack and then make the facility part of it? The panel feedback was it's good to have the awareness of the standards. It's good that those standards are existing, and there are a lot of connections between the OCP and those standard groups. So it was definitely agreed that those standards have still a reason to exist, but it's good for OCP to challenge those guidelines. A sixth one, you can see it on the green bar on the bottom. It's quite a no-brainer. Was the question if the communication should happen between software, IT hardware, facility. It's also recognized that security is a big political thing. So it's the gap was big. So it's not bridged yet. And maybe from IT to facility, it's easier than from facility to IT. But I think we are going there. That it will be more integrated, and it's within OCP also developed further, as I said, with the Intel paper. I think that we are on the right way there. Wrapping up this part is my conclusion is. As a data center facility working group, we know our position in the ecosystem. We are not making the software stack, so we are followers for the software stack. That's the position in the ecosystem. But what we can do and what we should do and will do is connecting with the other working groups. That's recognized within the facility group that it's even more key to get involved also in the other work streams, make them aware that facility is part of OCP, and try to get the right conversations and also adopt, see what's happening and adopt the standards to the facility. So I think that's making it a very nice group to work in and to follow the discussions in the group, because you will see that with also the communication from IT to facility, it's nice to think of the data center as of the future. That I mean with the data center is not the facility, but it's the IT, the software, and the building. So that's the next step to do. Also with the advanced cooling systems, that's getting more stream in rack and power. That's good. So that's the panel. From the panel, we need discussion. To close this session, I want to highlight, it's also recognized in the main track, you see circular with the presentation of Renew. Renew it in the main track yesterday, but also on other sites, that we are aware as a business we have a footprint and we should not run away of it, but we should understand that it is a business model, but it's also an environmental model together, and we as OCP, as front runners of the future, we are adopting it with all the working groups, and I think it's coming more and more into sight. Also, what Steve was saying yesterday, we are enabling climate neutral infrastructure, and if we return here next year, it will be even more on the agenda and make it visible, because we need also some marketing on this topic, that OCP is here way ahead of business. So we don't need to, we need to be aware we don't spoil on energy and materials, and maybe water is not mentioned, but really key in data centers. You see it, the discussion on water. So we put it on the agenda, also make good use of water or waterless. A circular approach, and for data centers, the energy storage is interesting, because with a good energy storage, you can skip the generators, and I think it's also a good step forward to be able to put data centers everywhere in our society, because the generators is you don't want that. If you want to choose, you want to skip the generators, in my opinion. So that's it. One picture, principles on the left, chain responsibility. The OCP is we are taking care of the whole chain as OCP, and in the middle it's the open data center. So that's my concluding my story. Thank you for your attention.